Okay, so you're ready for another deep dive, and today we're tackling bone fractures. You know, these resources really break down how these injuries are described, how doctors approach them right away, and then, you know, that whole process of healing. It's amazing.
It is. The most basic element, you know, as your sources highlight, is identifying which bone is injured. That's the starting point.
Okay, so that's like step one, right? Figure out which bone we're talking about. But then it gets into integrity of skin soft tissue. And that's where we have this big distinction, right, between a closed fracture and an open fracture.
Exactly.
And just to clarify for everyone listening, a closed fracture means the skin over the break is still intact. It's contained within the body, basically. But an open fracture, that's where things get a bit more serious, right? Because the skin is broken and that fracture site is exposed to the outside world.
Right. And that, as your material emphasizes, is a really critical distinction because open fractures have that much higher risk of infection.
Oh, yeah.
And there are even specific things mentioned that might point towards an open fracture, like if there's continuous bleeding from a puncture near the fracture site, or if there are these fat droplets in the blood.
Yeah, those are definitely not good signs.
Not at all.
Okay, so we know what bone and we know if the skin's breaking or not. Then it goes into location, and it's not just, you know, somewhere in the arm or somewhere in the leg.
Mm-hmm.
It's way more specific than that.
Oh, absolutely. And it really maps out, you know, the anatomy. We have the epiphyseal region, which is the end of a long bone. And importantly, that's the part that's part of the joint. Then there's the metaphyseal region. And that's like that wider part where the bone starts to flare out from the shaft.
Okay.
Then the diaphysis is the shaft itself. And even that, we break down further proximal, middle, distal, depending on where along the shaft the fracture is.
I see. So it's like giving it a really precise address on the bone itself.
Precisely. And then particularly important, especially when we talk about fractures in kids, is the physis, which is the growth plate.
Right. That growth plate that's so crucial for a child's development. Right.
Absolutely.
So we know which bone and exactly where on the bone. Now, what about the way the bone actually breaks? That's where we get to orientation fracture pattern.
Exactly.
And I was surprised going through this material just how many different ways a bone can actually break.
There are quite a few. So we have the transverse fracture, which is like a straight line across the bone.
Okay.
An oblique fracture is angled. And then we have this thing called a butterfly fracture, where you get a central triangular fragment that breaks off. It really does, in the images, kind of look like a butterfly.
Interesting.
A segmental fracture, that's where a completely separate piece of the bone breaks off. Spiral fractures, these often happen from a twisting force, and that's where you get that spiral corkscrew pattern.
Oof, that sounds painful.
Yeah. And then comminuted or multifragmentary, that's when the bone breaks into more than two pieces.
So like shattered almost.
Yeah, you could think of it that way. Then there are the intraarticular fractures, which extend to the joint itself. Compression fractures, where the bone is kind of squished, you often see those in vertebrae.
Right.
And then a couple that are more common in kids. Torus fractures, which are kind of like a buckling of that outer layer of the bone, and green stick fractures, where the bone bends but doesn't completely break all the way through. And then, of course, we have pathologic fractures, which are fractures that happen through bone that's already weakened by some other condition.
Right, like a tumor or something.
Yeah.
So many different ways a bone can break.
Yeah. And following the pattern, we have to consider the displacement.
Okay, displacement.
And that just means, simply put, you know, whether the broken ends of the bone are still lined up properly or not.
Got it. So if they are lined up, that's non-displaced. And if they're not, that's displaced. And I notice in the material you sent that there are all these specific ways a bone can be misaligned.
There are, yeah.
Like, they can be pulled apart, which is distracted. They can overlap, which is translated.
Right.
And then there's angulation, which is when there's an angle to the break. And even there, we have specific terms.
Oh.
Varus, where the point of the angle is pointing away from the midline of the body, and valgus, where it's pointing towards it.
Mm-hmm.
Like, imagine someone who's knock-kneed. That's valgus at the knee.
Right.
Varus would be like bow-legged. Then you can have rotational displacement, where the fragments are twisted, shortening, where the bone is actually shorter because the pieces are overlapping, and then avulsion, where a tendon or ligament actually pulls a piece of the bone off.
Yeah. And it's really quite remarkable because it allows us to paint this really precise picture of exactly what's going on. And
okay, so we have this fracture. We've got it all described. Now, what happens? What's the immediate response when someone presents with a fracture?
Well, the very first thing is really making sure there aren't any immediate life-threatening issues. That's the priority. So the initial clinical assessment always starts with the ABCs. airway, breathing, and circulation.
Right.
And that's part of this larger approach, you know, kind of the ATLS protocol, which stands for Advanced Trauma Life Support. And it helps doctors systematically address any critical problems first. And once those are taken care of, we move on to getting a really thorough history, understanding the background of the injury.
Okay.
And this is where, you know, mnemonics can be helpful. There's the AMPLEF history. It stands for allergies, medications, past medical history, last meal, events leading to the injury, and the patient's pre-injury functional status.
Wow.
That's crucial because it can give you clues, you know, about things like underlying conditions that might have contributed.
Yeah, like if someone had a pathologic fracture and it happened with barely any force, maybe there's something else going on.
Exactly. And then, of course, there's the physical exam, where the doctor will carefully look at the injured area, looking for any deformities, any skin problems, and they'll gently feel for tenderness, being very mindful of not causing any further pain.
Right.
And your sources make a really important point here, which is documenting the neurovascular status, so checking for nerve function and blood flow to the injured limb before moving it around too much. That establishes a baseline.
That makes sense. So you're not accidentally blaming something on the exam when it was already there.
Exactly. And after all that, pain management is a huge priority. Doctors call that analgesia, and it can be done in several ways. And then imaging. X-rays are usually the first line to confirm the diagnosis and see the fracture pattern clearly.
The good old X-ray. It's amazing how much you can see. I noticed the sources mentioned something called the rule of twos when it comes to X-ray imaging. What's that all about?
Yes, the rule of twos. It's basically a way to make sure that imaging is really comprehensive. So it usually means getting two views, an AP, which is anteroposterior, and a lateral view.
Okay.
Often you want to see two sides, so if there's a question, compare it to the uninjured limb. Then two joints, the ones above and below the fracture, to make sure there's nothing else going on. And often, images are taken at two times, initially, and then again after the fracture's been set, you know, after reduction.
Makes sense. So you're not missing anything. Okay, so we've diagnosed the fracture. What's next?
Well, the next step might be what's called reduction. And that's all about getting those broken pieces of bone back into alignment.
Right, like setting the bone.
Exactly. And there are two main ways to do that. Closed reduction and open reduction.
Okay.
Closed reduction is when the doctor manipulates the bone from the outside without surgery. It might involve traction, gently pulling the limb, and basically reversing the way the fracture happened. Open reduction is when surgery is needed to actually go in and realign the pieces.
Got it. And the sources actually had this interesting sidebar called no cast, and it outlines cases where open reduction might be the better option.
Right. So that would be things like if the bone isn't healing properly, which is non-union, open fractures themselves, situations where nerves or blood vessels might be at risk, displaced fractures that involve the joint surface, certain types of growth plate fractures in kids, when someone has multiple injuries, pathologic fractures, and then even cases where surgery is likely to give a better outcome in the long run.
I see. So it's not always a straightforward decision.
No, it's very individual. But one thing that's really important, regardless of whether it's closed or open reduction, is to recheck the neurovascular status afterward and get post-reduction x-rays to confirm that everything is lined up correctly.
Right. Make sure you didn't do any harm in the process of fixing it. So after reduction, what's the next step?
Immobilization, which is basically stabilizing the fracture so it can heal. And that can be done externally, you know, using splints, casts, traction, these things called external fixators. Or internally, using things like pins, screws, plates, rods, surgical hardware.
So you're either holding it in place from the outside or from the inside. I noticed the sources mentioned Buck's skin traction specifically.
Yeah. That's often used as a temporary measure, especially for fractures in the lower limbs. And it helps to improve the length, the alignment, and the rotation of the limb while waiting for, you know, more definitive treatment.
Makes sense. So you're kind of holding things steady.
Yeah.
Okay, and then there's follow-up to see how the healing is going, and then rehabilitation to get back to normal function and prevent stiffness.
Exactly. It's a whole process.